Welcome back to the Real News Network. We're talking to Victor Novasky. He's the publisher emeritus of The Nation magazine, used to be the editor and publisher for many years, now teaches at the Columbia School of Journalism and edits the Columbia Journalism Review. And he also wrote the book Mission Accomplished, which is all about how George Bush won the war in Iraq. And as you can see, this is a comic picture. So we're talking about where's the center, where's Obama, we're talking about foreign policy. We've heard a few stories recently about Barack Obama reaching out to various sections of the right. Stories are that in terms of his foreign policy and intelligence policy appointments, he vetted them to some extent through McCain. He wanted McCain's buy-in on them, and there's a story New York Times reported, or maybe Washington Post, that Lindsey Graham was acting as a middleman, and McCain wasn't sure of some of the appointments, and Obama's team went back and asked some more questions and satisfied McCain. Graham says later that McCain's very happy. He said, boy, I would have appointed the same people. President Obama has dinner a week ago at George Will's house, and he meets some of the senior right-wing columnists, Krauthammer and Brooks and George Will and William Kristol.
Who was fired the next day from the New York Times, so.
Oh, was Kristol fired the next day?
Well, his contract ran out and it wasn't renewed, so, yeah. So got a free meal out of it. So.
That's good. I'm sure he needed the meal. He's not someone who had sleep for dinner. Brooks reports on Meet the Press that Obama gave them the impression that 2 or 3 years from now, when the stimulus package has worked, hopefully, someone's going to have to pay the bill. Where did all this money come from? And Brooks reports that Obama's willing to look at entitlement programs as a way to deal with trying to defend the currency, because at some point people are very concerned about what inflation might come from all of this stimulus. So there's been various things about Obama reaching out to the right, and the more you hear about it, the more you start to wonder, what's that doing to the policy vision?
Well, again, this let me give you the optimistic interpretation, hope, but I have no knowledge or belief that it's necessarily going to happen this way. But it seems to me FDR, in dealing with the problems of the New Deal, was able to win the country over and he didn't get elected on this platform. He got elected on balancing the budget, but was able to win the country over to the importance of this whole panoply of programs which didn't exist when he got in, which come under the title of the New Deal. There are economists who argue it didn't really help the economy ultimately until World War II, but it was moving in that direction and took a step back and went forward. This is the answer to this question you ask involves a dialectical situation. It really is not, when he says, well, if we have to face it, we'll look at entitlements. I don't take that as a plan or anything. I take it as a conversation he's having. What, of course, you hope is the economy will prime the pump, and the economy will continue to grow, and you'll grow into a situation where employment increases, and that instead of investing in a military budget, you'll invest in the domestic infrastructure. But all of that has to start working to some degree, and then the Republicans who have opposed that in this vision don't get reelected, and the country moves in one place. The other one is the one that you're suggesting, and sure, but the question is, how do you jumpstart the whole process, and is he doing the right thing? Well, to me, it needs more cash than they're talking about right now to jumpstart it, and it can't be just the jumpstart. It's got to be a continual investment that goes on and doesn't happen once, and then you go back home. And that's something that folks like Joe Stiglitz and others are going to be writing about and have begun talking about, and I think it's a process of education. I think his intelligence and openness and chutzpah, as it were, in the face of the conventional wisdom at every stage in the campaign are signs that we're the country, to the extent that the president has any power, there's a big argument that there are only so many
things you can do. But is it possible there's a really that this this desire to compromise to have a united
I see it as a strategy to get us through.
Well, so, get what through? Like he's it's hard to remember a president that came into office with so much positive political capital. Yes. Okay. The popular support is really off the meter. Instead of coming out to some extent slugging with a vision, like on the auto package, a vision for working families that, you know, in the campaign he talked about, you know, the lower 90-95% don't have to pay more taxes, but that top 5 or 6% should. Yeah. We're losing that now. Now we're talking about either tax cuts again for the rich. It's all getting mushy again.
Why not come out clobbering? Okay. Well, first of all, you and I are probably, we don't know each other well enough, in agreement on the policy question. So the question is a tactical question and a strategy question. And in the campaign, the economy hadn't tanked yet. And the people weren't looking into the abyss yet. It was
near the end. It was right towards the end.
But when they were talking about the difference in tax plans that he had and Hillary had and then he had and McCain had, he wanted to tax the rich and McCain didn't. And that was the fundamental difference. And I didn't take that much vision there. I took a sentimental and instinctive sort of identification with the masses. And this is a good thing. And now he's got to get this economic, people call it stimulus, passed. And today, it looks like it's going to be passed. 3 weeks ago, no one knew that it looked that way. There was a lot of criticism against it from both the right and the left. The left, it isn't enough. The right is too much. And from both, there's no governance. They can use this money they're getting to acquire other companies, to pay themselves big compensation packages, to do all kinds of other things. And now they're putting some of those things in place. So I don't fault him for attempting to get the Congress behind this basic package. I fault him for the size of the package. I would like it to be larger. And then there are a whole set of other things that we have to look at. Now, we haven't discussed at all the role of the left in an Obama administration. And having said all the things that I do, which are kind of more optimistic and more hopeful and more giving him the benefit of more doubts than others in the nation office would, and perhaps you would, I think the role of the left is to put pressure on this administration.
Okay, so in the next segment of our interview, let's talk about how the left is going to do that and just what will be your litmus test to judge if he's responding or not. So please join us for the next segment of our interview with Victor Novosky.
Donate today and receive a new documentary film available to members of the Real News Network. The History of the National Security State with legendary author Gore Vidal. Bonus features of the DVD include an in-depth response to Vidal from ex-CIA analyst Ray McGovern, who served under 7 U.S. presidents, an exclusive interview with Colin Powell's former chief of staff Larry Wilkerson, and an insightful interview with oil policy analyst Antonia Yuhas.
News magazine of the screen. Living glimpses of history in the making.
Hollywood and Washington has a symbiotic relationship. They both deal with illusions. Reality doesn't often play much of a part. I think I saw through the myth of the Cold War almost from the beginning. I was a Washington political kid from a political family. Roosevelt first had radio because he had this great speaking voice that everyone liked to hear. Truman proceeded to break every arrangement that Roosevelt had set up for a peaceful coexistence. And Truman thought that it would be a good idea. Why not just stay armed all the time? And then he devised the National Security State. You've got to go up and swear allegiance to the United States or else you're a commie. I mean, we had imported fascism. We get Dwight Eisenhower, who said that we have this great military industrial complex. It is a dangerous thing. And he said, this is going to change everything. And the way our country's governed is going to change us politically. Along comes Jack Kennedy, who wanted to make his mark, believed in the Cold War. But he said, in this kind of politics, it is the appearance of things that matters. I think everybody should take a sober look at the world about us. The national security state still exists, only it isn't communism anymore, it's terrorism. This is the most serious thing that has happened in the history of the United States. Knowledge is power. We need an honest news system.
We need the real news.
This is the sort of thing we can build right now without anyone else's permission from the government or from the business community. It's the powers in our hands.
If we're not going to sleepwalk into more wars, we think we need to start with a television news network that won't bow to pressure and has the courage to seek facts. And that means independent economics. And that's why we need you.
Make a tax-deductible donation now of at least $10 a month or a one-time give of at least $75. As a thank you for your support, we will send you the new documentary film, The History of the National Security State.